Tonight, briefly before we close, we're looking at a very, very important subject that we need to give attention to when we talk about evangelism, the practice of taking the gospel, the good news, to other people, telling them about the love, the sacrifice, and the death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is the very essence of the gospel. So when we talk about evangelism and revival, there is a very important component that we need to pay attention to. And that component is the component of prayer. So tonight, I'm speaking to you on the subject, prayer that begets revival. Prayer that begets revival. In many circles today, people talk about revival. It is a common religious language in many assemblies, in many gatherings, in many places where people call upon the Lord, especially when you come to a block, a section of those who have believed in the Christian tenets, faiths, and doctrines, the Pentecostals, the Evangelicals. They so much talk about the charismatics too. They so much talk about revival. To some, if a meeting is called, a flyer is printed, a handbill is printed, and is shared among people, and people go all over the place, share the handbills, what is assumed is that that is a revival program. And you say that we are having revival going on in our church. We have revival going on in our assembly. But those people who say those things have least understanding of what revival is all about. They could have been just be too just or to be too honest to themselves to say that there's a program going on in our church. Or there is, because revival cannot take place before the program. Or revival takes place at individual level. They will have just said to us that we have a program and we expect that God will give us revival in that program. But not to say the mere fact that a program is going on, a preacher is in town, a big man of God has been invited, or even a crusade ground, things are happening, and the noise is all over the place. The television is carrying the news, the radio is carrying the news, the churches are sharing the flyers all over the place. And for the mere fact that there's a stirring up, or there's a sort of activity, or a kind of enthusiasm, a kind of whatever is happening, does not necessarily mean that revival is taking place. But people always misunderstand. They feel that once some people have gathered in a particular place, or people are sitting now in a particular place, or drums are being beaten, people are flying up and down, people are dancing, people are falling on the cold under anointing, and so many things are happening, so many noises are going on, and then they feel that is revival. But tonight, I want to say that before a church, a group of people, individual or assembly of God's people, people that are called on the name of the Lord or called upon the name of the Lord, ever experience revival, prayer always precedes revival. Prayer always begets revival. Revival doesn't come from wishy thinking. Revival will not come because we wish there were revival, or we wish we have revival. Revival will not come from just mere reading the word of God. as important as God's word is, but if the people that really want divine visitation, if the people that really want the touch of God, if the people that really want a turn around, a changing, a change, a transformation, a change of life, it was said of Charles G. Finney in America in the 18th century, a man that had been mightily used of God to bring down the glory of God and the blessings of God in the land of the America. That man gave himself to prayer. And Charles G. Finney, we pray for 6 hours nonstop. We pray for 24 hours nonstop. We pray for 48 hours nonstop. We pray for 72 hours nonstop. We keep praying and be praying. And his very flesh, his very will be broken. His mind will be broken. His very life will be first affected with the prayer of that revival before it flows out from him to touch the lives of other people. So what we are saying today is, if holiness, global revival of holiness ministry is going to experience the blessing of God, if global revival of holiness ministry is going to experience transformation, massive transformation, great transformation, wonderful transformation, spiritual awakening, the blessing, the outpouring of the blessings of God upon his people, individual families, upon an assembly, upon a congregation, upon a village, upon a town, upon a city, and upon the entire world, then we must first of all give ourselves to prayer, the ministry of prayer, the practice of prayer, the exercise of prayer, and that discipline to give ourselves to waiting on the Lord, that discipline to give ourselves to calling upon the name of the Lord, so that God will one more time visit his people. God will one more time pour out his blessing on the people. Maybe you are in your assembly and you see a lot of carelessness. You see a lot of upright sin taking place. Deacons are falling into sin. Leaders are falling into sin. There is lethargy. There is indifference. There is lukewarmness in the church. People not nonchalant attitude towards the church, towards the work of God. There is abject poverty of obedience to the word of God. There is clear voidness. There's clear people clearly disobey the word of God. People's hearts are devoid of the fear of the Lord. What the people do, people who come to church, people who hear the word of God, people who are themselves the teachers of the word or the servants of the Lord, when you hear the kind of thing that happened among them or the things that the people do, it breaks your very heart. It touches your very being, your very mind, your very will, your very heart, your very soul. It touches you and breaks you down, crushes you down, and makes you to weep and to cry and to weep and to lament and to cry all through like Jeremiah. When you go to your knees or you think of what the people have done, how their action have brought reproach to the name of the Lord, how their behavior in the society, behavior in the church, behavior in the community, behavior in the family, behavior in everywhere, in the section of the church, how those people that call upon the name of the Lord, how those people that are called by the name of the Lord, the things they do, that even the unbeliever will wag their head and hiss on the street and say, if these people who are called by the name of the Lord, if these same people who are called of who call upon the name of the, we hear them pray. They pray all night. They pray in the morning. They pray in the afternoon. They pray in their offices. But they cannot simply overcome temptation. They cannot simply overcome the temptation of signing a check or increasing figures in the office, and in the corrupt case in Nigeria and other parts of the world, as well in Africa and outside Africa. If they see the people that are called by the name of the Lord cannot simply overcome the temptation of adding more zeros to a figure and get some money out and loot the government, loot the company, loot the people. And these people are deacons in the church. They are counselors themselves. And they are called by the name of the Lord. They call upon the name of the Lord. We hear them sing. We hear them pray. They are so religious. and then common temptation they cannot overcome. When somebody hears that and you are a child of God, your heart is touched, your mind is touched, your heart is with them. You wish that the work of God will visit, the blessings of God will visit the people, will visit the assembly, where they call upon the name of the Lord. If you hear that kind of news, that is a bad news for you. That is a very, very terrible thing that has happened. Those news will move your heart to tears, will move your knees to bow, to bend down, and your heart will bleed and say, what? People that hear the word of God, people that are called upon the name of the Lord, people who sing the song Amazing Grace, how sweet it sounds, that says, a wretch like me, I once was born, but now I'm found, but now I was blind, but now I see. They sing that song, but you don't see the impact of that song in their very lives. When they open their mouth to talk, you say, what? Are these people Christians at all? Have they tasted of this grace? I tasted the grace of God that brings salvation. Teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, and teaching us to do everything to walk holy with the Lord. When you hear them talk like that, and it moves your heart to bleed, it moves your knees to bow, and you have a bended knees, and you cry all through the night, you cry in the morning, you cry on the street, you cry while you're driving, you cry when you see carelessness of sinners, how people just go about doing evil in the society, and you are there as a child of God. You are there that somebody that knows the danger that awaits sinners. You know that if this individual or this couple or this family or this group of people, should the judgment of God appear now in this area where I see evil, people are reveling in evil, reveling in sin, it automatically touch your heart, the very being, the very heart of your life, the when it matters your heart most, it touches you over there, and then you start crying. Not that you will sit down and be laughing and say, hey, see what all those unbelievers are doing. See that boy and that girl committing outright immorality on the street. People no more have shame. You won't laugh with them. You won't just be laughing and say, this world is spoiled. Well, what do we do? There is something you will do. Is there not a cause? Oh, ye that pass by. As you pass by in the neighborhood, you see those boys smoking and their lives is wasted. And those people have future, they have destiny. If only you can reach out the gospel of grace, the grace that brings salvation, the grace that teaches them to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, and that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this very present evil world. When you think about eternity, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade all men. When you think about all that, you put that together in your heart, you who have known the word of God, you know the judgment of God, you know the terror of the Lord, you know what will befall them if these people die today, if these people fell down today and give up the ghost, you know the very place they're going to go to spend eternity. And eternity is not something that is only for 1 year, for 2 years, for 10 years, for 15 years, for 100 years, for 1,000 years, for 1 trillion years, for 10 trillion years, but it's going to be forever and ever and ever. When you look at that and you pass by and you see all those evil, you see all those revelings, you see all those partying, you see all those immorality, you see the worldliness, you see everything put together, and you see the wickedness in our society, how one man can get angry and then set the whole city on fire, set the whole village on fire. What is the problem? And somebody offended me. That's why I get angry. And then you destroy the whole village. You kill the people. You end up a generation. You now have children, no parent, no father, no mother, because somebody gets angry with the government and throw away people and destroy the whole community and set the whole nation on fire. When you look at that and you are a believer, the question you should ask yourself is this. What is my role? What role am I to play in this place? What am I doing? What am I doing? What is my role here? What does God want me? What role does God want me to play? Am I just here for nothing? Am I here just to warm the bench in my church? Am I just in the church to just sing some hymns and draw some poor ₦5 or $5 or £1 or €1 as offering, and then wake up the next day, go back to my normal work, and come back the next day in the evening and say some few prayers and read some few scriptures in the Bible and sleep over in the night? Tomorrow you wake up again, the same cycle continues, and we are believers, we are living the society. What are we doing? We can't pray. We can't seek the face of God. Sinners are east in Zion. People are in the church and yet they don't obey the word of God. The elders are falling into sin. The pastor is falling into sin. Pastor tests lies anyhow. And then we are watching. We are believers. What is our role? Why did God leave us alive here in this world? It is for the sake of revival. And I'm trusting God that God will touch you tonight. And that all this sleeping, all this waking up in the night, we're not praying, we're just sleeping. And wake up, we eat the breakfast, we go to office, we come back, and then we sleep again. And then we read some Bible, we read some devotion, and then we wake up again. And this has been the cycle for 10 years, for 30 years in the faith. What are we doing? Church, what are we doing? So, that's why God is calling us today. A call for revival. And that revival cannot come except with prayer. Not prayer for clothing. Not prayer for food. Not prayer for promotion in the office. Not prayer for expansion of your business. Although those are legitimate things, they are good also. We need money for gospel work. We are having conference in December. We need money. I'm not saying we don't need money. We need money. Those things are legitimate things. But is that why God kept you alive? Having gone through what I went through this year alone, January 8th, I can't forget that story in a hurry. And what I went through in July to August, that I was between life and death for 3 days. I almost died. And having recovered from all that stress, one question I've asked myself, is it because of what? What is the real reason why God kept me alive? Is it to have some farm? Raise some chicken? Loiter around? If it were for those reasons, God will not just have delivered me from death, the valley of the shadow of death. But for this single reason, I have given my life over to God for. That if it is not that we have to see revival, then God should take our lives away. What am I living for? What are we living for? So this is a clarion call. That we should pray. Husband and wife, start prayer. Families, start to pray. Churches, pastors, hearing me on Facebook, on this platform, it is time to pray. It is time to seek the Lord till he rains righteousness upon us. Righteousness is falling on the street. Who values righteousness anymore? Who values morality anymore? Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Who values righteousness anymore? But the church and the world does not value righteousness anymore. The church is worldly. The world is churchy. You can hardly distinguish between the church and the world. And that is because prayer is lacking. If we start to promote prayer in our assembly, in our solemn assembly, in our gatherings, if we begin to promote prayer, and we promote prayer, pastor, hear me and take this serious. Come, let your church come and then pray and pray and pray. The number of people that attend church will reduce. And those are the sinners that will reduce. The believers will stay to pray. Practice it, you will see what I'm telling you. Because it is the very lifeline of the church. Prayer is the very lifeline of Christian life, Christian living. If there is no prayer, you cannot live the Christian life. Let's not even talk about revival. We're talking about prayer. If you don't pray, you can't live the Christian life. If you don't pray, you cannot overcome sin, temptations, and evil. What are we doing? We need to pray. We need reawakening. We need the touch of God. We need revival in our very lives. It is revival. When revival comes, it is that prayer, the prayer you want to pray, and you pray, and you pray, immerse the flesh, the desires of the flesh, the agitations of the flesh, the gratification of the flesh. That prayer of revival will first melt you and make you so broken that God can talk to you, to hear God speak to your heart. It's prayer. So tonight, I'm not going to teach some doctrine. No. We want to evangelize. And the only way we can evangelize is to pray. Is to seek the face of God. Is to submit our will. Is to yield our lives before God and ensure that God pours out his blessing upon us. And that will begin with us repenting from all known sins, bringing ourselves before God, repenting of our sin of prayerlessness and backsliding, and offering up our lives to the Lord, giving our lives to the Lord, and praying. It's not prayer for bread. This prayer is not prayer for protection from witchcraft. It's not prayer that promotes your business. No. It's not prayer that promotes your life, from give you promotion in the office. We're talking about promotion of the work of God among men, the work of salvation, the work of repentance, the work of restitution, the work of revival that brings people to the glory of the Lord, that brings people to repentance and brings people to righteousness, brings people to obey the word of God. That's what we're talking about. Church, start prayer. Families, begin to pray. Individuals, begin to pray. Seek the face of God. Lest the iniquity of the land will consume us as believers. The evil you see on the street, if we don't pray that God do something about the state of the church, that God do something about the state of sinners in the world, what consumes them will consume us. The church needs to pray. We all need to pray. We all need to bow down our heads and bend down our knees and bleed our hearts when we see what happens in the world, what happens in the church. Moral decadence. You could before easily advise people, counsel people. But today, no. People are callous. People are indifferent to the word of God. They are hearing the word. The word is not penetrating anymore. What will change that trend? What will make a difference is when the church prays. And I trust God that we're going to pray. Bow your head as we pray. Evangelism can never be effective without prayer. We're taking some time on this platform today to pray. This prayer now is to pray for yourself that God will revive you. I want to hear you really, 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 really pray on this platform that God will revive you.
In the name of Jesus, I look up to you, Jehovah. That is incredible. Upon my life, come, Jesus, I pray for you, and revive me, Lord, revive me, and for to revive my life, ancient, your spirit has passed over me, and then you just come, I look up to you, Jesus, and for to revive my life, almighty God.
Your right spirit in your God. Prepare me for your revival, God.
Restoration to fellowship with God.
Amen.
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 Open your Bibles with me to Isaiah 66, verse 8. Isaiah 66, verse 8. Who hath heard such a thing? Who hath seen such things? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth her children. We're going to dwell on this one verse and discuss a little bit before we go. Who had heard such a thing? Can a nation be formed in one day? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in a day at once? For as soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth her children. Definitely, here the scripture is not talking about physical childbearing, because Zion as a city does not bear children physically, biologically. Here, Prophet Isaiah is lamenting the state of God's people. Please, who among us are jealous of the name of the Lord? We call it today to lamentation. I have been weeping in the past 1 month. I weep while driving. I weep when I sit down. I weep when I talk to some people. I shed tears. How could we have backslidden? How could a child of God have backslidden to the point you pick your hand and write something and you know what you're writing is a clear lie? Are you still preaching? Falsehood? It has affected me. To tell lies deliberately? Who had heard such a thing? Can a nation be born in one day? Do you think a change, a transformation can come to a soul? A soul that has been kept under the bondage of corruption will suddenly turn to God. And that change, that transformation will take place without any supernatural power, without God's visitation. Can it happen? Where did you hear it happened? For as soon, this is comforting. It then means that if we keep praying, for those of us who are praying, if we keep praying and continue to pray, encourage ourselves to pray and keep praying and keep praying and keep praying and keep praying and keep on praying, for as soon as we get there, for as soon as Zion traveled, as soon as Zion became pregnant, and the pregnancy is on time or at time, and the sign of travail, a sign of labor, sign of childbirth comes forth. The amniotic fluid breaks and the water comes out, and then there are some contraction. Then there is hope. There is confidence now that we can have revival. It then means that if we keep praying, one day we will get there. Say amen to that. It then means that we are praying and have not seen Zion break forth. It simply means we have not prayed enough. That begets revival. When God intends to bless his people, he first sends them praying. This is a statement by Matthew Henry. You know Matthew Henry? Matthew Henry wrote a Bible commentary. Matthew Henry said, when God wants to bring forth revival, first thing God does to the people, he sets them praying. He provokes them to pray. He inspires them to pray. He puts burden, prayer burden, on the mind of the people. He takes away appetite from them. Appetite for sex, appetite for food, appetite for worldly things. They become dissatisfied with everything around them. They become dissatisfied with the status quo. They become dissatisfied with the normal, the common thing around, the trending thing around, the happening thing around. What excites other people no longer excites them. What makes other people happy, what amuses other people, does not amuse them anymore. Why? God had put a burden, a prayer burden, a revival burden, an intercession burden on their mind. And that burden overwhelms them. That burden takes over their mind. That burden is their last thought, is their first thought in the morning, is the last thought they think before they sleep. It takes away appetite for any pleasure in life. Anything that has to do with pleasure, it takes away that appetite. It takes away appetite for even carnal discussion among people, between friends. What people come together to get excited, and they get excited and forget themselves and talk and talk and talk until when they get back home to pray, they start confessing sins all over again. Because you remember, that's for those who still have conscience. For those whose conscience have not been deaded, for those whose conscience have not been seared with a hot iron, when they get back home to pray, they kneel down beside their bed, or they sit up, or they kneel down, or they lie down to wait upon the Lord to pray, they remember the talkativeness they have done. And they say that, they remember the scripture that says, in the multitudes of words, there wanted nothing. Then they begin to pray and seek for forgiveness once again. But appetite for anything, God takes it away from them. God takes away those appetites, appetite for wealth, appetite for worldly accumulation, appetite for anything of the world that excites them, that amuses them, that makes them happy, makes them feel they're on top of the world, makes them feel that life is at best in the state where I am now. Meanwhile, we see decay, we see immorality, we see falsehood, we see lies, we see evil, we see wickedness in the church, in the neighborhood. When God wants to begin a work among his people, when God wants to release blessing on a generation, when God wants to release his blessing on his work on earth, when God wants to turn the tide, Savonarola of Italy, a man who lived in Italy in the 19th or 18th century, turned the tide. He stood up as one man and said, evil has to stop. In this land, in this nation, in this country, and decided to pray and went on separated life and went was a sanctified life and went on a life of supplication and went on a life of solitary. He went on solitary life like Elijah, who was tired and fed up with the witchcraft of Ahab and his family, witchcraft of Jezebel and her husband, witchcraft of bewitching everybody, sending everybody that called on the name of the Lord to hide him. 7,000 people What a revelation. If God had not come up to tell Elijah that it's not only you, there are several more thousand people who have not bowed to Baal, who not kissed the mouth of Baal, nobody could have believed, nobody could have known, nobody could have ever thought that there were 7,000 other people who are the children of God, who are the people of God, who see hold the name of God in reverence, who see reverence God and honor God and worship God and have devotion and piety towards God. Nobody could have known that, except that it came from the mouth of the Almighty, because Elijah thought, I and I only. But then God did it. God came to him. But what I'm trying to say, it was that body. Perhaps, if Elijah had known that there were seven other thousand people who are in the land, he wouldn't have gone to God in prayer. But because he doesn't have that knowledge, and then that pushed him to God, he said, God, I'm going to live alone. He went to Mount Carmel and stayed there 3.5 years. Solitary life. Separated life. Sanctified life. Life of supplication. And he prayed. As soon as Zion travailed, she shall bring forth. And come. When the fullness of time came, after 3.5 years, Elijah told, go tell your master, rain is going to fall tomorrow. But that rain is going to signify a change, a transformation, a U-turn, changing and turning the tide. And Elijah turned the tide. When God wants to bless his people, he first sent them to pray. If we understand the concept and the phenomenon of revival to mean the returning of the people of God from a state of backsliding and apathy to renewed vigor, renewed consecration and obedience to God, then this state can only be attained to prayer. In Psalm 85, verse 4 to 5. Psalm 85, verse 4 to 5. Turn us, O God of our salvation, and cause thy anger towards us to cease. Wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Okay, no. Wilt thou be angry with us forever? Wilt thou draw out thy anger to all generations? Wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? Show us thy mercy, O Lord, and grant us thy salvation. Prayer must come before revival. It is the principal agent of revival. There must be prayer of repentance and complete turning away from all disobedience to the word of God. Second Chronicles, open your Bible. 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 14. In my people which are called by my name, 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 14. If my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and will forgive their sins, and will heal their land. Our land needs healing. Africa needs healing. Africa must be saved. Nigeria needs healing. Nigeria must be saved. Europe needs healing. And Europe must be saved. Asia needs healing, and Asia must be saved. Our land needs healing. Look at the moral wall that has been broken down. No more respect for one another. Someone can just pick a rifle, walk into your house. You did not offend him. You didn't cheat him. And out of anger, shoots you and kill you, and nothing happens. The blood we spilled in our land, especially in this country, Nigeria, the carnage, the killing, the bloodshed, our land needs healing. Look, it's not United Nations that will heal this land. It's God. And God will only work when he sets us to pray. It is you and I that can pray. Sinners cannot pray. Our land needs healing. The church needs healing. Believers must know the right time to pray, and it is time to pray. This is the time to pray. We must know the right time to pray for the promotion of God's work of salvation, God's work of repentance and revival, restitution, God's work of glorious transformation. We must pray that this work of God will be promoted amongst us, and ask God to send us revival. Ask God to send us revival. First Chronicles chapter 12, verse 32. First Chronicles chapter 12, verse 32. And of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do. What Israel ought to do. Having understanding of the time. The time we are living in. What understanding? These know also that in the latter days, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Come, you who are on this platform, 17 of you, and those who are watching on the Facebook, can any of you here seated, brothers and sisters, will tell me that you have not known the time we're living in? That you don't have understanding of the time. That you do not know that people are calling upon the name of the Lord and yet promoting the doctrines of devils, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with the hot iron. This know also, understanding the time. What time do you want to understand? This know also that in the latter times, perilous time shall come. Perilous time shall come. Difficult time shall come. Men shall be lovers of themselves, boasters, covetous, greedy, heady, disobedient to parents, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. That is the understanding of the time. Children of Issachar, which were men, women that had understanding of the time. Understanding of the time. That knowledge should bend your knees. That understanding of the time should bleed your heart. Move your mind to God to ask God question, will thou not revive us again that your people may rejoice in thee? Understanding of the time. Our time is fast spent. Shall we pray? Men of Issachar that had understanding of the time, men of Issachar that had understanding of the time, understanding of the time. May God Almighty grant you and I understanding of the time in Jesus' name.
Amen.